Hello, my name is Miguel Raz Guzmán Macedo, and I'm going to be presenting Rubin.jl towards symbolic integration for JuliaCon2021's lightning talk. So basic bit of history, 400 years ago there was a lone genius who was stuck inside during a pandemic and figured out how to do calculus and integration and brought that forth into the world. In 2021, we're stuck inside during a pandemic. I am not Isaac Newton, but I have some ideas on how to get symbolic integration to Julia. This is the story of how I've progressed and how maybe you can help out and all the mistakes I made along the way so that you don't have to do them too. Till here, haven't been able to figure it out. It's definitely not a weekend project, or at least I haven't been able to crank it out after some sustained effort. I'm sharing what I learned so that you don't make my mistakes and you can profit from my efforts. Julia can absolutely rock the space, and the end product should be able to ace undergrad calculus integration, arithmetic exercises, at least for a healthy subset of them. So why is it called Rubin.jl? It's based on previous work by Albert Rich et al. And on the rules-based integration project, so I'll just call it RUBI. And it's named after the physicist Vera Rubin. Why? Because she was stolen and never given credit for many of her discoveries, and I think the world needs more projects giving proper credit to scientists like Vera and less of egotistical men who are just willing to slap their name on ideas and call it theirs and shoulder everyone else out of the space. So what is RUBI? RUBI is trying to squeeze the most performance out of Mathematica's approach to integration via syntactic rewriting rules. So this is the same thing that you did in high school, but 50 times, but done by a computer. So what you're looking at here is Mathematica code. This is the power rule integration that you learn from a table at some point. And so they'll tell you like, oh, if you see an x raised to the m power, and it is the case that m is not equal to 1, then you can just apply this rule blindly, right? So x can be a symbol, it can be whatever, and you just raise it to the power of m plus 1 divided by m plus 1, and then you're good to go. So that's the essence of RUBI. There's about 8,000 of these rules because it gets really hairy. It gets out into the funky special functions. And what's really cool is that you can build out a binary balance tree so that the queries of if these syntactic rules apply happen to you try to minimize how many matches you have to try and do for many of these. So this is like, it's taking Mathematica's approach to the fullest extent, and it's using it with a different engine. Importantly, it's not using any Mathematica internals code, which would be a licensing nightmare. And that would make the project a non-starter. But since it's free and on GitHub, if you scratch it hard enough, you can find these rules. And so they're in my Julia repo now. So what do you actually gain from all of this? You know, why is it worth going through all of these problems? So, oh my God. Let's do some live editing. Why not? What do you gain? Yes. Oh, here's a slide. So here's what you do gain. What you do gain is that RUBI has about a 99% coverage over about 72,000 test cases, whereas Mathematica only has about a 72% coverage, and Maple is at around half of that, right? And then RUBI is also about 10 times faster than Mathematica for many of those, and there's an entire grading system. But the point is, it's faster, it has more coverage, and we really want to do it. So how do we do it? You have to get the right files, because you know they've fortunately made this open source, and so it's all somewhere on the internet. You have to get the right files, you have to parse them, you have to dump them all into a JSON. And here's my idea of it. You have to dump them all into a JSON. You have to transfer the JSON into a symbolic backend of your choice, whether it be Julia or Rust, and we'll talk about that in a second. And finally, world domination. That's after that. Right? Easier said than done, because these are the instructions to draw an owl, right? It's like, oh yes, just have to draw it. So here's how I got started. You have to get the files. I had to chase down a lot of leads. It was just a nightmare because I ended up trying to parse even PDF files, which is not something you should do in your spare time, to, you know, during the year of our Lord 2020 and 2021. And it's fortunately I was able to track it down. And with Julia, you can use artifacts so that other people can just download my repo, and then all the dependencies will be insta-handled and it'll be easy to use. So, you know, that was a headache, and I could have saved myself like 3 or 4 weeks of work if I just started with in the right place, but, you know, it's done. Next, you want to parse them, and you can use this amazing package called File Trees by Sashi Gowda, and it takes like 5 seconds to parse like 8,000 of these rules. The magic line here is filetrees.load fs do file, and then I overloaded the parse function so that it does so. Because every single integration rule is a single line, then you can load all of the sort. This is for the tests, right? The other case is a bit more complex, but don't worry about it. I wanted to load all the tests first, and every single test is just a single line in many of these like structured folders. So with file trees, you can just auto parallelize all of that if you can reduce your problem to parsing a single line. And I was able to, right? Or at least for some subset of them. And that's an ongoing effort because it's tricky. It might also not be most profitable to use a Mathematica syntax suite. We could probably use a Maple syntax suite because it's friendlier on Julia syntax. Third, you want to dump it into JSON. Why? Because we're not going to be the only symbolic backend. There's probably a multitude of symbolic backends that could profit from this. And it turns out that a lot of people have tried to reinvent the wheel. This is like my basic one for trying to capture the integration rules, and it's still missing out on many of them. And the ones you do capture, you can use JSON3.jl and struct types, which are amazing. So shout out to Jacob Quinn. Oh my God, it's cut out for that. And that's great. But it's great. And here's how you can use the artifacts, right? That just loads it up wherever it needs to from. And then you can use it accordingly. It turns out that I'm not the first person to attempt this. There's a SimJava effort that was done, and they also have an ungodly amount of code to try to just parse all of this. SimPy tries this, but it absolutely fails when you get to special functions, and they will just spit in your face. But you can tap into them with PyCall if you're willing to look at their code for a while. And then if you want to transfer the code, then you're looking at parsing Mathematica codes, and then you start seeing that these are like heavily brittle, very artisanally crafted, order dependent rules that can absolutely be borked if you just do things in the wrong order. So I'm stuck here. Parsing Mathematica is just a giant wolfram yak to shave, because there's just a lot of shenanigans that I've never faced before, and the most amount of regular expressions for parsing that I've faced, I learned during the advent of code, which was amazing in the Julia community. But, you know, I'm just not an expert on this, and there's a couple other people in Julia that have tried it, and they also were like, it turns out this is work. So, you know, yeah, that's what happens. So why is there a renewed interest in Julia? Well, first of all, there's the entire symbolic .jl ecosystem that Chris Rakakis and Yingbo Ma and Sashi Gada are launching, and many others. And so all credit to them. And there's been a recent algorithm. So first of all, we can use Julia, which is oodles faster than Mathematica, except for their pre-built special in-house functions. So it's not even going to be a contest. Second of all, there's been an algorithmic breakthrough, and there's also been a usability breakthrough by the team behind eGraphs. And that's a Rust implementation where they get around this problem that you had in high integration, where if you apply certain rules, it would destroy information. That was called the phase ordering problem. And since eGraphs get around that with integrals, it's very, very profitable not to have to redouble your efforts when you're trying to do this. So getting eGraphs into Julia and using Julia itself is, plus the inherent parallelism that we can exploit, is just all the signs for a field ripe for disruption. So that's why we're hopeful, but I'm probably preaching to the choir. And if you haven't, you know, you should check out Julia. Finally, that's it. Thank you to all the amazing Julia community. This effort takes a village. Please reach out. A big thank you to Luis Bennett and David Sanders, who are the first ones to teach me about coding in Julia. And a special shout out to my GitHub sponsors, Logan Kilpatrick and Hector Patricio. Thank you.